Ed. Ed Clark. He's actually preaching Kenosha. He'll be preaching, kind of preaching indefinitely, for a while until they finally pass in Kenosha. Good to have all of you. Have an added challenge. Let me see. One, two, three. There are three of you suffering from jet lag, right? Phil, you shouldn't be that bad. You had a whole year of vacation. So welcome back, guys. Three guys with jet lags here. This passage will be so exciting that if you fall asleep, I'll be calling you out by name. All right, we have our passage today is from 1 Samuel chapter 11. Okay, we're going, if you have your Bible, open to that chapter. Now, last time, if you recall, a week ago, last time, you should not have forgotten, we talked about how there's a king. But it's actually rather kind of unordinary in the sense in that this king is not somebody whose people are too excited about, okay? First of all, this king went into hiding when his name was called. And in a sense, this calling of this king was in the seems like judgment. In addition, the chapter ended with the two people, I mean, not two people, I think Phil Shania, some people thinking, saying to Saul the king, will this man actually save us? So people are casting doubts left and right about the legitimacy of this man as king. Well, what's going to happen this chapter? Well, this man was chosen by God. We're going to see how from the beginning of this chapter there's doubt, speculation, suspicion about this man. But at the end of the chapter, there'll be absolute confidence that Saul was a man chosen by God. What's the difference factor? The difference factor is very simple. It's actually found right smack in the middle of this chapter. It's verse 6. It is the Spirit of God. You see, when the Spirit of God is working in your life, when the Spirit of God gets a hold of you, He will lead you into doing great things for Him. God's Spirit is powerful. And if you're a child of God here today, if you're a true son, true daughter of God today, you have the Spirit of God living in you. The same Spirit that is in Saul is in you. Well, the manifestation might be different, and we'll talk about this. But the point the author is trying to tell us, the point the author, the scripture is telling us all over the place, is that when the Spirit of God works in your life, it makes all the difference in the world. It doesn't matter what your circumstances are. So it's the Spirit of God, okay? So this chapter, very simply, you can break up into three different parts. First of all, is the introduction. Enemy. Secondly, Spirit of God. An effect. Oh man, we'll get to it. The Spirit of God has on Saul and what he did. Last of all, we'll see as a conclusion, as a result of what the Spirit of God does. All right, let's look at the first part, the first one. Let's see the problem. The problem is this. The problem is that this enemy of God came. Paul just read for us about Nahash the Ammonite coming to attack. Now Nahash, this man, you never heard of this man, this name just jumped out of nowhere. But most of you, if you have even read the Bible, you have heard of the Ammonites before. Derek, you heard of the Ammonites before, right? Have you? Yes. All right, here's the harder question. Where did the Ammonites come from? Excellent. Ammonites came from an ancestral relationship from Lot and his daughters. Now, this goes back a little bit to the history. I just want to cover this real quick. I have a point to make. Lot was a righteous man in Scripture. And what happened was that when God was about to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah for the awful things they were doing, God saved Lot and brought him out. And what Lot did after he came out was that he was fearful and he lived in a cave. And because he avoided other saints of God, this happened. He could very well have gone back to Abraham. He could very well have been with God's people. But instead, he decided to live in the cave. And that's what happened. This is a very important point. And this is kind of light of the news that happened this week. I'm sure you guys all read it. The Turpin family, his homeschool family with 13 kids. They were malnourished, they were tortured, they were abused. So much so that the 29-year-old was only 82 pounds. Now, I never talked to the man. I assumed that he would claim that he was a named Christian. He was Christian. What went wrong? I want to bet you one thing. I haven't come up yet. I want to bet you they don't belong to a church. Or if they're a church, a home church, their own family church. I almost will bet you $5. I could do more. I don't have much. I almost bet you they're not part of a church. You see, friends, brothers and sisters, God put us in a community for a reason. There's a reason God made covenant with his people. People with each other. For accountability, for encouragement, for walking in Christ. There's no way I could walk a month without the church, without the fellowship, and yes, the rebuke. Daughters won't be able to stand me. Yours too. Kids. Or your family. You need the church. That's what happened to Lot. Well, out of that, okay, yeeky things that happened. Came this people, came this enemy, Nahash, the Ammonite. Now, went up and besieged Jabesh-Gilead. And an all man, Jabesh, said to Nahash, make a treaty with us and we will serve you. This man was a bad dude. Bad, baddest dude. How bad was he? There's a little history behind this. There, in Josephus, to talk about how this man has actually terrorized not only Jabesh-Gilead, but has actually terrorized everything east of the Jordan River. Now, picture Israel with me. Israel, most of the time, you know that there's a river, the Jordan River, that divides, that's the territory of Israel. Everything on the west side is territory of Israel on the Jordan River, right? Except the 2.5 tribes of Israel that's actually on the other side, western side, eastern side of the Jordan River. The eastern side of the Jordan River, the 2.5 tribes, and they wanted that land because that land was actually great for raising steaks. If they had Kobe steaks, it would be right there. This was the best place for raising steaks. The only problem was that they, Ammonites, claimed that this was their land, even though God had allotted it to them. So all through the history of God's people, there was fighting, fighting, fighting over this. And Josephus actually said that he was terrorizing the whole region. He was going around gouging the right eyes of everyone out. And Jabesh-Gilead was the last stronghold. Let me ask you a quick question. What's the significance of gouging someone's right eye out? Anyone want to take a quick stab? Don. Okay, you'll make them unclean. Because it's not so much their handicap that making them unclean. What would make them difficult when you gouge out someone's right eyes is that you almost make military service impossible. Think about this. In the old days, when you fight, you care usually most men will carry the shield on their left hand. They'll carry a spear or a sword on their right hand. If you get your right eye gouged out and you try to block with your shield, you can't see. And that's the whole point what Nahash wants to do to God's people. He didn't want to kill them. He wanted to shame them. And you want to make them slaves, and you want to make them useless. And you know, it dawned on me that a lot of times the enemies of God's people sometimes don't so much want you dead as to make you useless to God. See, if you're dead, you can be a martyr. A lot of times when you're a martyr, you actually spread the faith. But if you're actually useless, made useless to God, in some ways that's even better. That's what the devil wants. The devil wants to make you useless. Claim the name Christian, but useless to his service. How will you do that? I'll quickly jot down three things. Three ways. You know, God, the devil, the world can make us useless. First of all, it's by belief in falsehood. You see, if you doubt God's goodness, if you doubt, let's talk about this real briefly. If you doubt God's word, what do you have to fight with? The Bible itself says the sword of the Spirit is the word of God. If you have doubts about God's word, if the enemy is always spreading falsehood about God's word, and we talked about that today in high school, Sunday school, is that if you're always doubting about God's word, if they doubt about the resurrection, you are basically no use to God's kingdom. Secondly, The other thing the enemy will try to render us useless is by temptations. It goes without saying that we live in a hyper-sexualized world. Fashion, everything is to appeal our senses. And it's so easy to fall prey at that. See, if you become a slave to sin, if the enemy could get you, and there are lots of places to hide today, guys. Lots of places to hide where no one will ever see you. If you can hide, become a sin, a plaything in your head, you're not going to be any use to God's kingdom. He's got you. The devil's got you. And that's what he wants. He wants you to frit your life away uselessly for his kingdom. I mean, for the devil's kingdom, not for any good for God's kingdom. Third of all, he wants to shut you up. He doesn't want you to preach about his word. I know some of you face tremendous amount of pressure where you work. If you make any statement about what God says about marriage, you're in a lot of trouble. These are ways, but this is just another way the devil, the world, try to make you incapacitated. No use for his kingdom. What do we need to do as God's people? We as God's people, he called us to fight against our temptations, to fight for our faith, to look for opportunities where we can to speak for him. Of course, we do this with wisdom. Well, let's look at this. Look at the deal. The elders of Jabesh said to him, "Give us 7 days respite that we may send messengers through all territory of Israel. Then if there's no one to save us, we'll give ourselves to you." This man is so full of confidence that you will win that he lets the messengers go. So we have all these things against us. What is going to change? Well, let's come to the story now. Here the messengers came to Gibeah of Saul. And when the messengers came to Gibeah of Saul and told the news, what did everyone do? Everyone cried, wept. This man's way too powerful. It's just like what we've seen many times. What is your temptation? Whether it's your sin, whether it's some power, whether it's some arguments. What are you going to do? Well, look what God did. The answer is God's Spirit. God gave His Spirit to us. And that is why we have hope as Christians. Now, on Friday night, we had a youth group. I asked Christine a question. I'll ask her right now again. Where is she? Oh. I asked Christine a question. If you could have me teaching the Bible or Jesus teaching the Bible, what would you pick? Well, actually, don't answer. What do you think Christine answered? What would you say? Judy, would you have me or would you have Jesus? Jesus? thanks. I thought we were friends. Nancy. That was a trick question. Come on, guys. Anyone? Of course you will say Jesus. But you know what Jesus himself said? He said, it is good for me that I am going away. See, if I go away, I'll send the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, to you. If I do not go away, I will not send him to you. What you have with Jesus left is that you have, if you're a son or daughter of God, you have the Holy Spirit in you. You have Jesus himself living in you through his Holy Spirit, empowering you, guiding you, leading you. And this is what happened here. Now, and he says here, now behold, Saul was coming from the field behind the oxen. And Saul said, what's wrong with the people that they are weeping? So they told him the news of the men of Jabesh. And I love this. It says, and the Spirit of God rushed upon Saul when he heard these words, and his anger was greatly kindled. He took a yoke of oxen and cut them in pieces and sent them throughout all the territory of Israel by the hand of messengers, saying, whoever does not come out after Saul and Samuel, so shall it be done to his oxen. Then the dread of the Lord fell upon the people. They came out as one man. That's amazing. Fear gripped them. What changed? God's Spirit rushed upon him, and he actually was filled with anger, first of all. And brothers and sisters, this is very important. We have heard all over and over again that anger is wrong. Yes, most of the time anger is wrong, but there is a place for righteous anger, righteous indignation. Jesus was just angry when they were selling in the temple. Remember, he took a piece of rope, tied them together, and whipped everyone out of the town, out of the temple. And Paul himself says, be angry, but do not sin. It's possible to be angry. In fact, sometimes the right answer response is anger. If you can see injustice and it does not affect you, that is sin. So here, God's Spirit worked in Saul, caused him to have anger. I think the Spirit of God does that in our lives as well. He brings conviction. He brings God's truth into us. And when he brings God's truth into us, we start seeing things God's way, and it makes us angry. And sometimes it makes us angry enough against our own sin that we want to change. It makes us angry against injustice. It makes us angry against lies. And makes us study. And so what happens is that they came out as one man. You know, there's another thing here that's happening. There's a wonderful ministry of the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God actually rouses you up in anger. When we see anger, there's dread. And there's fear. There's a good kind of fear. When we fear God, more than we fear man. That's what we need. That's what the Spirit of God does. And that's what God wants to do in your own life, in my life. We need to read, study His Word, and His Word will do those changes in us. But But here's another change. I want to point this out. It's that God's Spirit not only does all these things, but he also restores. What's very interesting is that they gather in this town called Gibeah, right? What happened in Gibeah? If you go back, if you could read Hebrew, if you just flip back to the previous book is not Ruth, it was actually Judges. And the last part of Judges was an atrocious thing that happened in the town of Gibeah. Where a bunch of men assaulted a woman and ended up killing her. And then the whole tribe of Israel wiped out this town. And scripture says that they came as one man to fight against them. And here, they came as one man to this town to fight against the enemy. You see, the scripture tells us, so one of the work of Spirit of God is not only does he call us, not only does he challenge us, but he also restores us. Out of this place of sin, God brought forth a new beginning. So what failure you may have in the past, and now obeying God's law, and now obeying God, with repentance, God offers you a new beginning. So let's look at what happened. So he mustered in at Bezek, the people of Israel with 300,000, the men of Judah 30,000. They said to the messengers who had come, "This shall you say to the men of Jabesh Gilead: tomorrow by the time the sun is hot, you shall have deliverance." When the messengers came and told the men of Jabesh, they were glad. Therefore the men of Jabesh said, "Tomorrow we'll give ourselves up to you, and you may do to us whatever seems good to you." I love that line. When the man of Jabesh said to Nahash, "You may do whatever seems good to you," literally they said, "You can do whatever is good in your eyes." This has two meanings. First meaning is that Nahash said that he was going to gouge out their eyes. So these are playing a pun on that. But the second meaning is this. The last line of the book of Judges is this: "In those days there was no king in Israel. Everyone did what was right in their eyes." What the man of Jabesh Gilead said is that there is a king. So they were, you know, when they were saying that to the man of to Nahash, that Ammonites, he did not see the sparkle in their eyes. There's a king, as King Saul, and more importantly, it's God. God is that king. And so the next day, he says, the next day Saul put out the people in three companies, like Gideon did, and they beat them. Beat them so bad that the scripture here says that those who survived were scattered so that no two of them were left together. That's the amazing gift of God, wonderful deliverance by God himself. And it's all happened because of the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God working the life of the church is what turned the church, what turned the world upside down. You know, the Spirit hasn't left. We looked around and we say the church is not turning the world upside down. Who's not believing who? The problem is us.
Spirit of God is still working. And we need to have faith to believe. To believe God. Now, there's a lot we can say about this, about God's Spirit. You know, I know most people want to talk about all of the miraculous gifts. And in this room, we have all these, we have probably a whole spectrum of opinions, of beliefs about how God manifests His work. But at the very least, we need to see is that God's Spirit is what made the church grow. And what it is Him who's still working in our lives. Do you believe that? See, God may want to accomplish great things in your life. God may want to do some great changes. God may call you to stand up. We Christians live in fear. We do. But God's word says that God's power is in His people. Your son, a daughter of God, His power is in you. Jesus is in you. Jesus Himself said, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. And literally, Jesus says, I am coming to you. And this is, I think this is, that statement was written for us in the 21st century. Because it's not just something in the future. Jesus is coming, is here by the Spirit to His people. Let me finish here, lastly, the conclusion here. Let me just read this part. Then the people said to Samuel, who is it that says, shall Saul reign over us? Bring the men that we may put them to death. But Saul said, not a man shall be put to death this day, but today the Lord has worked salvation in Israel. And Samuel said to the people, come, let us go to Gilgal and there renew the kingdom. So all the people went to Gilgal and there made Saul king before the Lord in Gilgal. There they sacrificed peace offering before the Lord, and there Saul and all the men of Israel rejoiced greatly. What's the effect? Conclusion. First of all, there are two things. There's forgiveness. Samuel some people said to Samuel they want to kill the people who they once saw as king. And Saul says, not a man shall be put to death this day, for God hath brought salvation. You know, the amazing part about this statement is that there's a parable that Jesus told in which this line is almost used the same, but it's completely different. It's the parable of the 10 minutes. This man went to go to a distant country to receive his kingship. But the people did not want him to be king. And they protested greatly. At the end of the parable, in Luke chapter 19, this man who received the kingdom, who is actually basically Jesus, came and said, the one who did not want me to be king, bring them out and put them to death. And by this, Jesus says that one day there will be a time of judgment. All those who reject Christ will be judged and punished eternally. There is that day. But this day, so the day of forgiveness means that today is the day of salvation. We need to turn to Christ for forgiveness. And also, besides forgiveness, we see that there's affirmation. Saul was affirmed as king. I want to challenge all of you something this week. Just take a step of faith. take a step of faith to God. It doesn't have to be really big. I'm not trying to, don't do something that will get you fired from your work. But just take a little small step. Maybe share with a coworker. See what God does. Maybe trust in the Spirit of God. See what God does in your life. He may do something amazing. You might not know it. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you. Thank you so much for your word. Thank you today again for the reminder that you don't